Hello students, today we will complete our chapter 2 of the book Indian Economic Development. Till now the topics discussed in this chapter were economy, economic system with its three types, namely capitalistic economy, socialistic economy and mixed economy. Next topic discussed was plan and the basic four objectives behind each 5-year and 20-year plan. Then agriculture sector, its importance, problems, reforms and government policy regarding it. Then we did industry, its importance. And the topic industry continues in this lecture also. Now in respect of industry, it is equally important to know what is the meaning of small scale industry and how it contributes in the growth of an economy. The Government of India defines a small scale industry in terms of investment ceiling in assets of a unit. This investment limit has changed over a period of time. Initially, in 1950, an industry was considered as a small if its investment in asset was maximum rupees 5 lakh. Then it was increased to maximum rupees 1 crore. Now it has been further raised from rupees 1 crore to rupees 5 crore in respect of 69 items reserved for manufacturing in the small sector. Some features of small scale industries are that exercises are labor intensive. They use more labor and generate more employment. Secondly, a number of products are reserved for the SSIs being making them able to manufacture the goods. Third, SSIs are provided the concessions as lower excise duty. You should know that excise duty is a tax on manufacturing. Fourthly, banks also give credit to small scale industries at lower interest rate, and a separate bank for them is also established by the name of SIDBI, SIDBI, as Small Industries Development Bank of India. Small scale industries can utilize small funds more efficiently and generate revenues to their investors. It was all about small scale industries. Now we will look into both positive and negative side of industrial growth during the planning period 1950 to 1990. First, the positive effects of planning period. There was about 6% per annum growth rate of industrial sector, not bad. Industrial sector became well diversified by 1990. Promotion of SSI gave opportunities of investment to small investors also. Now, negative effect of the planning periods were that public sector resulted in huge losses due to their bad management and ad hoc planning. Also, domestic production could not meet the international standards in quality. Policy makers tried to save foreign exchange through production as a substitute of import, but they did not make effort to strengthen foreign exchange reserve by export promotion. They emphasizes only on import substitution, not on export promotion. Now, our last topic to discuss under economic planning is trade policy. Trade policy in the form of import substitution. Before we go into this, we should know why this policy was needed and what is this policy, how it works, how it helps in the growth of an economy. Actually, India's imports bill were increasing by 84.5% from 1950 to 1960 due to increased import of food grains, raw material, capital equipments and machinery. India's dependency on import was rising. it resulted in deficiency of balance of payment. Due to this deficiency, foreign exchange crisis began and developed a lot. This situation was going to be more worse as import prices of petroleum, iron, steel, fertilizers were continuously increasing. Therefore, India had to take a large external help from International Monetary Fund IMF in terms of borrowings, which increased debt liability on India manifolds. Therefore, to correct this balance of payment deficit of country, various policies were introduced like export promotion. Because if we will export more, then our balance of payment may be in surplus. Second policy was adjustment of exchange rate. Third was fiscal and monetary reforms. Fourth is structural reforms, and fifth is import substitution. In our lecture, we will do only import substitution as it is a part of our chapter. Import substitution is one of the most important methods. We changed our industrial policy, which was closely related to the trade policy. In the first seven plans, trade was characterized by inward-looking trade strategy. Technically, this inward strategy is called as import substitution. The objectives of policy of import substitution were to save foreign exchange of the country. Look, if we will substitute the import, means if we will not import and we will produce at home, we can save foreign exchange. Second objective behind import substitution was to motivate domestic production in place of import. Third objective behind import substitution was to protect the domestic industries from foreign competition. Another aim of policy of import substitution was to establish a strong industrial base in the country. Another aim was to make the economy being capable of producing both consumer and capital goods at a future date instead of their import. There was one more aim behind import substitution, and that was to achieve self-reliance. If we will not import, we will produce at our home, we will become self-reliant. Protection from import was in two forms, tariff and quotas. Tariff means to impose tax on import, so that the imported goods become more expensive and their demand is discouraged. As law of demand also says, when prices become high, their demand falls. In the same way, if we impose tax on imported commodity, then imported commodity will be expensive and its demand will fall. Whereas, quotas specify the quantity of goods which can be imported. Both tariff and quotas could help in restricting the import. Now, what is the effect of policy of import substitution on industrial development? Impact of import substitution was both in positive terms and both in negative terms. First, we will see positive side of the import substitution policy, and that is the achievement of India's industrial sector during the first seven plans was quite impressive. The proportion of gross domestic product contributed by the industrial sector increased from 11.8% to 24.6%. It is an important indicator of economic development. Annual growth rate of industrial sector was 6% per annum, which is really good. Industrial goods were not restricted to cotton, textiles and jute only, as earlier was the position. Now, industrial sector became well diversified. One more positive impact was promotion of small scale industries. Also, the protection from foreign competition enabled the development of electronics and automobile sector, which otherwise could not have developed. So, these were the positive impact of import substitution policy. Now, some negative impacts. some goods and services were produced only in public sector. It was observed that often monopoly of public sector was formed, but this was not required. It is said that if these goods and services were de-reserved for private sector could work better. Private sector could give better result than given by public sector. For example, telecommunication. Telecommunication service sector was reserved for public sector only, due to which till the late 1990s, one had to wait for a very long time to get a telephone connection. But if this sector was handed over to private sector, this could not be happened, and the consumers could get services soon without waiting for a long time. Therefore, it was argued that government should hand over the production of those goods and services to the private sector, which private sector can also produce efficiently. And government should concentrate its resources on important goods and services, which the private sector cannot provide. Another drawback in the policy of import substitution was that many public sector undertakings were incurring huge losses, and there was no hope of their revival. But it continued to function, as it was difficult to close a government undertaking, even it was burden on nation's limited resources. Here we don't mean that private sector unit is always in profits. They also suffer losses, but they do not waste resources by being kept running the units despite the heavy losses. Private sector unit quits when it is in losses and there is further no hope of their revival. Another drawback was in the form of license. There was a need to obtain license to start an industry. It was okay. But this law was misused by big industrial houses, as they obtained license not for starting a new unit, but to prevent competitors from starting a new firm. To permit license for starting a new business unit was becoming license raj, due to which new firms spent most of their time in obtaining license rather than to think how to improve their product. Due to restriction on import, consumers were facing low quality goods produced by our domestic producers, and also high prices, not the competitive prices. Owing to all these problems, economists called for a change in our policy. So, a new economic policy was introduced in 1991. Concludingly, it is the turn of summarizing the whole chapter. Let us make a summary of progress of Indian economy during the first 7 plans. First, positive impact of 7 5-year plans. First positive impact is that growth was impressive, that our industries became more diversified, that India became self-sufficient in food production due to green revolution. Next, land reforms resulted in abolition of hated zamindari system. Now, negative impacts of economic planning. Firstly, the performance of public sector undertakings was very poor. Too much government control prevented growth of entrepreneurship. Our policies were only inward oriented, and there was no focus on development of strong export sector. Considering these negative effects, change in economic policy was desired, and that's why new economic policy was initiated in 1991. And also, since 1991, the 8th 5-year plan was introduced. So, this was the conclusion of all this chapter. Thank you.